on Chronicle.
The downtowns are the heartbeat of any community.
The attraction of downtown.
This is a spot that people love.
From the hustle and the bustle of city streets.
I mean, it has everything you could need.
To the small town charm.
It's more like a family, relaxed atmosphere here.
What lures people downtown?
That's why so many cities come here, to see what we've accomplished.
And what keeps them coming back?
The entertainment, they love the vibe down here, they love the food.
It's a destination. It's a place where you want to go. It's a place when your family comes into town, you want to bring them downtown.
Now on Chronicle, Destination Downtown.
Welcome to Chronicle. I'm Jane Robillot. If you want to find the heart and soul of a community, go downtown. From bustling city streets to quaint small towns, each one of them has a personality of its own. And it can be delightful to explore those unique and local flavors that often extend beyond the center of the city. I'm in Noma Square. This is kind of the birthplace of modern downtown Greenville. Back in the 1960s and 70s, downtowns were dying. Then Mayor Max Heller led the effort to build the Hyatt Hotel and a parking garage right here at this crucial corner. Four lanes of Main Street became two. Trees were planted and the Renaissance began. And now the whole world has taken notice. Tourists want to visit it. Other cities want to replicate it. Developers keep laying new footprints on it. And our Michael Cogdill found the pulse of it.
It's a rhapsody in green.
I want to live here.
So many moving parts.
Got that small town feel.
Moving the pulse.
This is different here.
You can feel it.
We didn't do things to attract tourists.
Just walk in the main.
We built our downtown for ourselves, for us to enjoy.
That artery from North Main, crossing the Reedy River, surging west, so full of life, it actually lives here.
We drive up, stayed at the Marriott.
I think this is where we're going to live.
Pam and Mike Hastings moved to downtown Greenville from New York.
Everybody's much nicer.
Much nicer and open and not guarded and friendly.
Mayor Knox White wanted to wake the neighbors to come downtown.
To realize the wonderful personality of our downtown.
And the town woke up the world.
And then the tourists come.
It's down home, it's not pretentious. To me, it's a comfortable place.
And consider this, a little over 15 years ago, there was no Fluor Field, no Green Monster. Outside Boston, no Liberty Suspension Bridge. Falls Park was pretty much under a highway. And back then, up on the roof, didn't mean anything quite like this.
And when night falls, the pulse quickens.
Calling for tuxedos, not uncommon. Tommy Hall of Hall's Restaurants, a Charleston boy, loves the feel of this Greenville.
A little bit of everything in this town. You can go have a good cold beer, also have a great glass of champagne.
The lights come on.
Such a great walking city.
Everybody feels right at home.
It's my neighborhood.
I'm in the suites business.
Come daylight, a sweet reminder walkability is good business.
I refer to myself as the mayor of the West End.
That self-described mayor of the West End, Bobby Doherty, expanded Old Europe Pastries here from Asheville because he felt so welcome.
I knew Greenville, one, from a cultural standpoint, two, business friendly, and number three, they continue to draw people from all parts of the country here. So for me, it was not really a very difficult decision.
So much coexistence.
It's why people from everywhere want to come here and live.
The rhapsody that is Greenville plays on.
We are not just a so southern, you know, bumpkin kind of town. We're doing some really good stuff, and we got a lot of things to be proud of.
And the pulse is strong.
It's a town that's going to embrace you and make you feel welcome.
It's real.
Michael Cogdill, WYFF News 4, Greenville.
That vibrancy and attraction that you find in downtown Greenville didn't just happen. It's the result of decades of partnerships and planning. But it wasn't until the new millennium that tourists seriously took note. And leaders from other cities did too. Greenville has a formula, a a recipe for its secret sauce, and Mayor Knox White is happy to share it.
You know, why did somebody just the other day come up to me and say, your city is dazzling? I thought, wow, dazzling?
But accurate. Downtown Greenville has a vibrancy that's unique, putting it on many national magazines' list of best cities. Tourists have discovered Greenville, and so have other cities eager to create the same.
It's just being able to inspire other communities to make their downtowns better, because downtowns are the heartbeat of any community.
Since about 2005, the city and the Chamber of Commerce have shared this secret sauce with towns, big and small, all across the country. Do most Greenvillians know that we're being copied?
No, I'm sure they do not.
Kind of flattering.
The list is this long now of cities that have taken, very overtly taking elements of our roadmap, if you will, and applied them to their cities, and it's a wonderful thing.
As a result, Fort Wayne, Indiana now has a baseball stadium that looks much like a certain stadium in Greenville's West End. Downtown Greensboro, North Carolina, right now is updating its streetscape with public art.
The Swamp Rabbit Trail inspired the Central Arkansas Greenways Trail System that is currently in the works.
MetroPlan's trail system will connect towns throughout four Arkansas counties.
Yes, we looked at Greenville and was like, wow, this is awesome, and we want to bring it back to Central Arkansas.
Greenville's modern success can be traced back to a plan by a nationally known landscape architect.
I keep on my desk the 1907 Greenville plan. It's actually a very good plan. In 1907.
Inside that plan was the game changer for downtown Greenville.
To reclaim the Reedy River, and in particular, reclaim Reedy River Falls.
But it took almost a century to make that happen. The four-lane Camperdown Bridge that obscured the falls had to come down. And money needed to build the 26-acre park had to prove to be a good investment. And it did. Five times over.
If we invested around $18 million for Falls Park, within just a few years, we had over $100 million in private investment.
Greenville entered the new millennium with the centerpiece of its personality, the waterfall, the park, and the Liberty Bridge.
That's the summation of everything I would tell of the cities is, you know, do the mix of activities, but above all else, find your waterfall.
And forge those partnerships with the private sector. That's what gave birth to Greenville's Peace Center for the Performing Arts, the baseball stadium, and the Bon Secours Wellness Arena, breathing vibrancy into the city's restaurant and hospitality scene.
Getting the residential downtown is critically important, and for many cities, including Greenville, it doesn't happen naturally. You have to really work it.
The work began by offering an ugly 1970s city parking deck to a developer who wrapped parking with residential. That welcomed people to live downtown, putting folks on city sidewalks after 5 p.m.
Well, we had the beautiful trees, but they weren't lit. Now we have lights in the trees. And we filled the downtown with public art. We even have public art for children with Mice on Main. And that's amazing, too, because it creates a bond between children and their city.
Greenville makes those connections to the future while being intentional to preserve the beauties of its past.
The Points at Hotel opened in 2000. We committed ourselves to not letting those buildings be torn down anymore. So it gives authenticity to a city, one of a kind.
This recipe has benefited not only the lands far away.
And so from Greer to Traveler's Rest to Simpsonville and on, you can see the mix of uses, the attention to green space, residential in the downtown.
Downtown Greenville, a destination for families and fun, and also a model for change and success. Greenville's recipe traveled north to Traveler's Rest. It was once considered off the beaten path. But now, as our Nigel Robertson shows us, the Swamp Rabbit Trail has become that path, opening opportunities to showcase the treasures within TR.
Welcome.
It's just blossomed, it's just bloomed. And so lots of things to bring you downtown.
To Traveler's Rest.
It's a gem. I mean, it's an absolute gem.
Where did the name come from?
It was a place where I think they were driving some animals down and they would rest here before they made on their journey.
Their journey from the breathtaking Carolina Mountains to the north, on their way to Greenville, just minutes to the south. For decades, there wasn't much here.
Kind of a small town for sure, you know, the railroad was still running.
An active railroad right outside Sunrift Adventures.
It shook the whole building, you know, kind of because it's so close.
That railroad was turned into a 22-mile multi-use walking and biking trail. A trail that continues to be a major highway, if you will, drawing countless numbers of people into the city using their own 2 feet.
There definitely was a TR before the trail and a TR after.
Shanice Chris is a member of Travelers Rest City Council.
But yes, the trail is bringing in so many people.
It's awesome. Travelers Rest has really, really bloomed since at least the last time I've been here.
Restaurants, bars, shops, and more along Main Street and beyond.
The food, again, is great. That's the reason I come.
Business here has never been better, especially when you can experience it trailside. Just ask the owner of Pink Mama's Ice Cream.
People now are, that's what they're looking for, something that's not normal, something that's a little bit different. This is one way to experience from Greenville all the way to TR. There's so many little stops along the way, and it's all really small businesses. And the cool thing about TR small businesses, most of them are women owned, which is amazing.
Just a few blocks away from the Swamp Rabbit Trail is what's being considered the next big thing for the city. This is the Pinestone development. Behind me used to be a large warehouse that has been removed. What's coming next? Take a look.
It's gonna be a large development, and I think it's gonna change the way that Travelers Rest looks.
It will have around 250 apartment units, 120 single-family homes, 77,000 square feet of office space, and even a trail leading to downtown and back to the Swamp Rabbit Trail itself. And just off the trail, another new concept for the city and the upstate, treehouse living, called Station Trailside Cottages.
And it's gonna be right on the Swamp Rabbit Trail when you enter Travelers Rest. It's gonna be short-term rentals, and they're gonna be like small tree houses.
The vision is a kind of Airbnb where, yep, you guessed it, travelers can ride into the city and rest.
It's awesome, it's fantastic.
Bringing us back to the very name of the city and all the new things just up the road. Nigel Robertson, WYFF News 4, Travelers Rest.
Travelers Rest is also a college town. In 2013, the city voted unanimously to annex Furman University into the city. And yes, the Swamp Rabbit Trail runs right through campus.
It's expanding all the time and turning into a really great place.
What's giving Anderson that electric feel? Plus, the Clemson you might not know.
It keeps on catering around families.
Investing in outdoor spaces and its youngest generations. Coming up next on Chronicle.
At least one city in our area can lay claim to a national first, and traces of that legacy live on in Anderson. It's in its nickname, and it's reflected too in its plan for the future. Carol Clark takes us to the Electric City.
Anderson, the first city in the U.S. to light up the town with a continuous supply of electricity. In the 1890s, William Whitner used hydroelectric power to light the city and operate a few businesses.
One of the jokes at the plant was that they had electricity running out on the floor. They were creating so much power that it could hardly be used.
Now the energy continues, plugged in to making the downtown a powerful draw.
We have a master plan that's called Shock This Block.
Shock This Block builds on revitalization projects that began in the 1990s. It identified seven specific gateways to downtown. Examples, the South End with a new hotel, parking garage.
Walking in, pot de creme, poached pear.
New restaurants. North Main at Calhoun, the AMP Plaza project with a brewery, restaurants, green space.
It's like quaint and small, but has like good eating places, and it's just a, you know, wholesome environment for families and stuff.
Places like Carolina Wren Park.
I do like that it's got some things to do, especially out here, the splash pad, great for the kids, especially on hot summer days.
The park has outdoor performance space for productions like Mamma Mia, a musical that brought in capacity crowds every night it played this summer.
And we just so happen to be adjacent to the largest man-made lake in the region, so that helps too.
Lake Hartwell provides another gateway to downtown.
There's a lot of economic investment we have from having the FLW and Bassmasters here. And, you know, Bassmasters continually says this is one of their favorite places to be.
The Bassmaster Classic is the Super Bowl of bass fishing, bringing an estimated $25 million to the region. The hotels and motels along Clemson Boulevard provide another entry point to the city, playing host especially to Clemson fans during the football season.
We're really excited about Anderson University. In 2024, they're going to be having their football program here with the Trojans, and they've just hired their head football coach.
Often talked about how the Greenville Drive made a difference in the Upstate. And I think AU and AU football, that's our Greenville Drive.
There's growth and expansion.
We know we're hot right now. We know that there's investors and there are, you know, people that are wanting to relocate here. So we want to do this right.
For many people, doing it right means not losing sight of what makes the city unique.
What do I love about it here? I love the super cool restaurants, the amazing people that you get to see. The chocolate shop, that's always a favorite. And just that it's expanding all the time and turning into a really great place.
Plugged in to a place that still has that electric feel. In Anderson, Carol Clark, WYFF News 4.
The North Main Calhoun Street project is the latest in the Shock the Block master plan. It's restaurant, open space, and magnetic South Brewery set to open sometime this fall, a new destination. Well, Clemson could be the most popular city in our area, thanks to those Clemson University Tigers. But it's just because of that the city's facing an identity challenge. Our Nigel Robertson takes us to Clemson to show us how the city is growing even when the university students aren't in town.
Welcome to Clemson.
It's an oasis that a lot of people don't know is here.
We aren't talking about this Clemson. We're talking about this one.
We want to share our story as a city. We know that we have a lot to offer.
Meet Robert Halfacre.
I'm the mayor of the city of Clemson.
This city is one of the fastest growing parts of the Upstate.
Two national championships will bring a lot of attention to our community, which we're very thankful for, but also brings some challenges.
From traffic to parking to dealing with a population that doubles, even triples, for 9 months out of the year. But the city is investing heavily in a number of things it says are constant and generational. Take, for example, Little John.
They always think of the Coliseum.
Not this one, but this one, Little John Community Center.
It's a safe haven where we can come and showcase our talents. Little John has been around 25 years.
Here, people of all ages can take part in community programs.
We cook here, we play, we educate.
Just up the road, in the heart of the city, Clemson offers a food scene from all corners of the globe. Plus, over the past few years, the city and surrounding area has had an influx of development, apartments, hotels, and more popping up as far as the eye can see.
The thing about the Clemson area is it seems to be available and open at all seasons, right? There's no beginning and there's no end to what you can do.
The city and surrounding community investing in the outdoors in a very big way. They're adding hiking and biking trails, connecting everyone to the great outdoors.
So we also have Nettles Park. Nettles Park is expanded. We actually acquired an additional 90 acres within the last year. And so we're real excited about the rec facilities, the sports, you name it. Again, it keeps on catering around families. Our youth, we look at it as it's a generational vision.
And then there is this.
It's a constant magnet that draws people in.
The city is currently annexing 12 Mile Beach. This will provide public access to Lake Hartwell in a way Clemson has never seen before.
It became available to the city for recreational use for the community at large. And they've done an incredible job fixing it up, cleaning it up, making it ready for any and all that want to be here.
There will be beach access, boat ramps, and places to just sit and relax right on the banks of the lake. And again, all within the city limits.
When you have like a Clemson football game or a concert or, you know, heck, there are business trips here all the time. And you got boating, you've got jet skis, you've got rowing, you've got sailboats. There's world-class fishing here.
In other words, now you can't tell the story of the city of Clemson without talking about the water. A city where the land meets the water, and the water meets that Clemson sky. Nigel Robertson, WYFF News 4, Clemson.
We knew what a gem that it was, but it needed to be polished.
From sending goods out to luring tourists in, how Greer is becoming a destination in its own right, plus good eats and fascinating culture.
People that live here love it.
When Chronicle continues.
For most of its history, the city of Greer sent things that it produced out into the world, shipping cotton, textiles, and peaches. The products may have changed over the years, but Greer is still a sender. Now it's becoming a receiver, too, of tourists. Carol Clark on the city's plan to be a destination.
Many cities and towns begin as a wide spot in the road. Greer began as a wide spot for the railroad. When the railroad ran through James Greer's farmland in the 1870s, he put up a train station. It became a shipping hub for upstate cotton.
That brought lots of money, so much so a special bank vault had to be installed at the post office.
Downtown flourished along with the textile industry.
We saw people coming to service that industry from all over the world because the textile machinery required that.
Sound like a familiar plan? A century later, when automaker BMW chose Greer as the site of its North American plant, it also brought supporting businesses, attracted too by that reputation as a place that shipped to the world. The Greenville-Spartanburg Airport, the inland port, with a direct rail line to the Port of Charleston, both in Greer.
We can't even begin to calculate how important that is to this area.
But between the prosperous past and the promising present came a hard time for Greer. In the 70s and 80s, textiles dried up. Downtown, too.
We knew what a gem that it was, but it needed to be polished.
So Greer turned to its treasures.
We're very, very fortunate. We have got the quintessential turn-of-the-century intact downtown.
From the late 19th century into the 20th, and most are on the historic register. So from under old plaster emerged painted signs from a century ago. And in 1998, a plan to preserve all that and make Greer a destination. Up first, a new city hall bordering a downtown park that hosts attractions like Greer's Freedom Blast Festival in July. Next, the streetscape project. Pedestrian-friendly streets, brick paving, no curbs, festive lights overhead, easy access to the shops and restaurants along Trade Street, close parking, electric trolley carts.
Oh, we like coming down here. We're going to get a little something to eat over at the Oyster Place. We like to go to the park, walk around.
John Miedrick likes it so much, he's moving to Greer from Long Island.
We fell in love with it. It's an unbelievable place to raise a family, a wholesome place, God and country.
The streetscape thing has just been incredible. I mean, we get new customers and people in all the time.
Smith and James has been on Trade Street since 1916.
This store is the oldest retail store in Greer.
He grew up watching his dad run the store, and then, after college, began running it with him. It's a family thing. Right next door, his sister owns a boutique and a thriving mini mall.
And my sister cuts hair three doors up, so the whole family works on the side, same side.
The sense of community builds loyalty in many who grew up here and lures newcomers.
I have just been so thrilled with is to see a city that is growing and thriving and building and doing so with a really deep sense of their roots.
A family atmosphere in a town determined to remember its past while it looks to the future. In Greer, Carol Clark, WYFF News 4.
And Greer continues to make plans. Parkview Greer is in the works. That development will overlook City Park and feature retail space, a brewery, and a restaurant. Now down the road a bit, downtown boom continues in Spartanburg. Longtime locals and newcomers too are proud to say that that country hometown feel isn't going anywhere. Our Patrick Hushin caught a ride downtown for an inside look at the culture, the growth, and what's in store for Spartanburg.
The Hub City. Real Estate US News says it's one of the top 25 places to live in the country. Home to Milliken & Company, Denny's headquarters, delicious chili dogs, and nearly 40,000 people downtown.
There are so many exciting things downtown.
Janice Pack has lived here for over 70 years, and today we're on a quick 3-mile trip with her. Destination, downtown.
There's something for everyone.
In 1974, Janice wrote a letter to city leaders describing what a struggling Spartanburg could and should become.
Street lights and hanging baskets and sidewalk cafes and music on every corner.
Then she waited for change for decades. But now?
We just needed to burst open. That's what's happening. It's awakening.
It's an awakening that sees more people moving to the area. Ed Dillahunt says diverse options downtown brought him here, and
the quietness too. It's very comfortable here. If you want to spice up country and city, it's right in between it.
Quiet, yes, but nowadays just look and listen. It's clear city leaders understand the importance of people living downtown.
People are moving downtown like crazy. They're building apartments and places to live.
At last count, there are nearly 1,200 apartment units proposed, planned, or under construction downtown. Stopping in for a quick bite, Janice meets up with a group of lifelong friends. A former florist shop, business at Blue Moon Specialty Foods is blooming. And Spartanburg pride is always on the menu.
Tremendous pride. I think we want people to know, hey, you know, we've got a great downtown. We've got the arts.
You just can't lose if you love art.
Spartanburg has now been designated a cultural district by the State Arts Commission, And folks I talk to say that growing diversity is yet another source of pride in Spartanburg.
I've seen black-owned businesses specifically open up downtown where we didn't have those. You know, we have Small Cakes, we have At Stevens, we have James and James that's open in the Montgomery building. So it's good to see businesses that look like me.
They've got it going on, and I'm so proud.
The future's bright.
The future's bright, yeah.
And it's even brighter as you look up, with the addition of more hotels, making out-of-towners comfortable and putting heads in beds is becoming easier. It's a reality Janice hoped for and wrote about nearly 50 years ago.
My vision for Spartanburg was just like it's become. I mean, I couldn't be happier. It's exceeded my expectations.
What does home mean to you?
Home is a place that you love where you live. People that live here love it. We're just going to keep on going. It's exciting.
In Spartanburg, Patrick Hushen, WYFF News 4.
And the push for wider diversity continues. Downtown Spartanburg will begin its Business Accelerator program in September. It's designed to identify, prepare, empower, and sustain African-American entrepreneurs who are looking to open or expand a business there.
The downtown with a lot of personality.
Some people would say that it's weird.
The weirdness of Asheville that has folks coming back for more.
We're an undiscovered gem of the upstate.
And a revival for some smaller towns. Coming up next on Chronicle.
Welcome back to Chronicle. The beauty of Western North Carolina helps Asheville keep its spot as a top tourist destination. The city's minor league baseball team is even called the Tourist, and the locals are proud to call it home. But Gabrielle Komorowski discovered that it's a unique mix that continues to draw people to Asheville, the land of the sky.
In this part of the Blue Ridge Mountains, it's all about that view.
Every piece of the inn is positioned to draw in the view.
It's been more than 100 years since E.W. Grove built the Grove Park Inn.
Yes, ma'am.
I've got those doors for you.
Even in those days, Asheville was seen as a wellness destination. You came here for rest, relaxation, for your health, and to get better.
The promise of wellness attracted some of the country's wealthiest. George Vanderbilt opened his massive Biltmore estate in 1895. The estate is one of the area's largest employers and largest attractions.
It's incredible. I mean, we're just flabbergasted.
In 2019, 1.5 million people visited the Biltmore estate. Data from the Asheville Convention and Visitors Bureau shows that the number of people making overnight trips to the Asheville area went up by 17%. From 2015 to 2019. They come for the clean air and mountain breezes.
So the weather's really nice, the scenery's really nice. I just love it here.
And not far from the retreat of the mountains, downtown, there's a beat on the street.
I would say it's a little different.
We've heard the phrase, keep Asheville weird.
Some people would say that it's weird.
So we asked the mayor of Asheville what that means.
It's a place where people can sort of be themselves, and that comes in a lot of different flavors.
More than 120 independent restaurants downtown, more breweries per capita than anywhere else in the country, have earned Asheville the nickname Beer City USA. There's a lively art scene and the weekly drum circle.
We're a funky town.
Weird is good because weird is unique, and unique draws people.
And so much of this area's uniqueness comes back to nature.
It's something that we're drawn to naturally. We're drawn to water.
Zen tubing gives people the chance to experience the French Broad River on a tube, and it is fun.
They can do this trip and feel really comfortable, relaxed, and enjoy the beauty of a river.
On an average weekend day, about 2,000 people spend the day floating on this 3-mile stretch of the French Broad River. And this isn't just about going with the flow. There are major efforts to take care of this water.
I mean, the French Broad is the lifeblood of this area.
Asheville Greenworks is dedicated to keeping the French Broad River clean.
Well, we actually pump out 25% of our water here in Asheville to be used as our drinking water. So we try to say to folks, we all have a connection to the river.
Here, there is a special connection to the nature in a thriving, growing city.
We want to make sure that there's opportunity for everyone here and that they can enjoy a good quality of life in Asheville.
A place where people feel free to enjoy the beat or just relax. In Asheville, Gabrielle Komorowski, WYFF News 4.
The scenery and the vibe of these beautiful mountain counties is a great draw. Gabrielle now takes us to Henderson and Transylvania counties. Each brings that special downtown feel, but also a uniqueness and a few surprises.
On Main Street,
we're having a really great time out in front of Tempo Music. I am a builder of cajon drums.
In downtown Hendersonville,
there's a huge energy here to the mountains.
That energy is heard and felt.
They love the entertainment, they love the vibe out here, they love the food, and they love this small town feel.
Cruising up and down the street is a trolley.
That's the oldest soda fountain in Western North Carolina.
Eva Ritchie is the voice.
They all came up here basically for one reason.
The historic Hendersonville tour.
That's why Cab Calloway came here and Jack Dempsey.
The reaction has been, oh my goodness, I never realized, you know, how much there is in Hendersonville.
Bobby, go slow when we go by the aquarium.
Including pieces of the ocean.
I think the biggest personality fish-wise we have is our stingray Charlotte. She loves attention.
This is the aquarium and shark lab.
We have two sharks right now.
By Team Echo.
Most people are really shocked that there's an aquarium in the mountains.
The goal is to teach the beach.
Especially the kids that don't get to see it and don't get to go to the beaches or the ocean, so it's always fun watching the kids get to experience it for the first time.
Eva's trolley also stops at the train depot.
The railroad arrived here in 1879, and that's when the population ramp just went up.
And people keep coming here.
I'm talking to people who are from Greenville, South Carolina, and from Tennessee, and from Florida. This is a spot that people love.
Tourism numbers from 2021 show people visiting the Hendersonville area are staying longer.
It's the weather, and I think it's the slower pace of life. You know, people come here and they can relax. It's easier.
Just about 15 minutes from downtown Hendersonville is DuPont State Recreational Forest, famous and loved for its rushing waters. The little river here connects Henderson and Transylvania counties, and people are drawn to this natural beauty that's accessible not far at all from Main Street.
I think for the sheer volume of trout water that's available, it's probably up there with anywhere else in the world.
Wormy, wormy.
Davidson River Outfitters in Brevard helps anglers access these beautiful,
fish don't live in ugly places,
peaceful spots.
And generally, there aren't a lot of people around in those places.
To cast and catch.
Good one. Whoa.
the native Appalachian brook trout. That's our one native trout in this area.
They say the appeal of angling has grown.
The more people get out and appreciate and enjoy public lands like that, the more people are invested in wanting to see those lands protected.
And just downstream is downtown Brevard. Main Street has a theme.
And he starts telling us about the white squirrel, and I said, a white squirrel, that's not real, is it?
That brings people here.
The famous white squirrel shop of Brevard, North Carolina. It's been here for 35 plus years.
Lorraine Scala is the owner.
We have over 2,000 white squirrels right here in Brevard.
She says almost 100 years ago, white squirrels escaped from a circus caravan in Florida. They were brought to Brevard.
Well, they're kind of territorial. They stick together like bats.
And they multiplied. Lorraine says the squirrels come to her yard.
They show up every morning, and there's at least 12 of them that come every day.
Visitors who don't see one can buy a squirrel souvenir.
They find anything from an umbrella to a nail file.
Numbers show visitor spending is growing faster in Transylvania County than nearly every other county in North Carolina.
People are very friendly, and I like the stores.
Because it's a down-to-earth kind of hometown feel.
There's something very genuine about it all.
And plenty to do in these friendly towns with breathtaking backdrops. Gabrielle Komorowski, WYFF News 4.
For every big city in our area, there are dozens of small towns figuring out how to thrive on that hometown feel. Stephanie Trotter takes us to one such town, Elberton, Georgia.
If I had to describe Elberton in any way, I would call it an old soul.
The pace in Elberton is much like the granite the town is famous for. Smooth, reliable. As other rural towns fade away, Elberton's success is etched in stone. Withstanding the one foe you just can't stop, time. A few steps off the town square, Addison Scarborough prepares for the day at the Peach Petunia.
I'm definitely proud of the growth that we've made.
The fashionista opened her boutique during COVID and has watched second-year sales almost double. Growing up in Elberton, she had to drive an hour away for a decent pair of jeans.
I definitely want Elberton to grow. I do like the small town life. I don't want to live in a big city. There's nothing wrong with that. I just enjoy small town life.
Good morning. Thank you for calling Samuel Elbert Hotel.
That life goes on one block away as housekeepers fluff, fold, and straighten at the Samuel Elbert Hotel. The historic building had sat empty on the town square for 15 years when the city acquired it and pumped $5 million into restoring its Tudor splendor with modern touches.
After it had been revived and people are parking on the square again and staying here, they're here at night, you can see life here, and that draws more life into downtown.
From monotone to vibrant color, native Lanier Dunn has witnessed the square's evolution across four decades.
Yes, the trends will change, the clothing will change, the services will probably change, but I think our geography and our the look of our downtown would be much the way it is today. And that's what we want to hold on to.
The city's next big project is to renovate the Masonic Temple. It's the oldest building here on the square that was built just after the Civil War. The plan is for two shops to go on the first floor with apartments up above.
Increasing and growing and thriving.
Leslie Friedman leads the Chamber of Commerce, guiding business growth almost 10% this past year.
There's an instant sense of community that you don't always get other places, and people thrive on community.
A community that's growing.
I like the small town feel.
At a pace that allows the granite capital of the world to stand as strong as the city's monuments.
The heart of Elberton is its people.
Stephanie Trotter, WYFF News 4, Elberton.
In the upstate of South Carolina, the town of Lawrence goes way back. It's named for a patriot of the American Revolution. Henry Lawrence couldn't see then what was in store. Michael Cogdell now from an old town experiencing a new revival.
On a summertime Friday night, who would
would guess this is a really old mill town.
Lawrence is becoming a destination spot.
Ray Reeder works at Palmetto Brothers Dispensary, a watering hole in the town square.
Cheers! Took a blow dryer and a comb and I teased it a little bit.
Still had some hair when the mill shut down in the 90s. She has a sense of humor about it.
And it gives it that full body, you know, that people have come to expect.
A sense of pride is showing in how downtown Lawrence found its way back.
It's brought people of Lawrence back together, and they've got a meeting spot now.
All helped along by the hip young mayor.
I mean, of the mayors in the state, I'd say I'm one of the hipper.
Mayor Nathan Sinn and the downtown merchants helped to create that nightlife.
We are an undiscovered gem of the upstate.
He found his way back to his hometown from another old city he loves, Charleston.
So I hope we've brought a little bit of Charleston here, where we value our historic structures.
Meaning like Charleston, Lawrence is charmingly old. What Disney had in mind, only real.
The real life version of what Walt Disney was trying to create with Main Street America at Walt Disney World.
And you know, there's no place like home.
Barrett Holmes should know the military took him all over the world before he came home to Lawrence. He owns and preserves pieces of the town now.
These are the pine floors that were here in the 1880s.
The 1880s just cut a new legacy.
The beadboard ceilings are still there. These are the original plaster walls, all the brick. Everything is original to the building, the 1880s.
And with that new legacy building here in the downtown, Lawrence is shedding part of its past. That used to be a storefront, a business called the Redneck Shop. Now it's anything but. In fact, the sign out front reads rehabhate.com.
It's sort of been an albatross that's hung around our neck that locals don't identify with.
The mayor will tell you most of the locals never like the Redneck Shop, but they love a man from far away from here.
I was born northwest of Syria in a Kurdish area.
Yvan Youssef opened Roma's Italian restaurant on the square in 2003.
Friday, Saturday, here's booming.
Years before the boom, he was the only place open past five. He'll tell you how Lawrence opened its heart to him.
When we go anywhere, as soon as I get close to Lawrence, I feel peace. It became home.
In many ways, Lawrence is becoming an old home to the new South.
We are seeing a lot of diversity in the people that are owning our businesses, and they're all being successful.
Locals like Jonathan Eyrick and others succeeding in bringing new life around that square.
We're seeing probably more young people coming downtown on the weekends and in the evenings than we've seen in probably the last 20 or 30 years.
Their old mill town becoming more of a thrill town for everybody.
It's not just the mayor. It's not just Main Street, it's everybody working together to make us special.
Michael Cogdill, WYFF News 4, Lawrence.
How this fast-growing city is keeping its small-town feel.
If you want to feel like you belong, that you always have a friend here.
Coming up next on Chronicle.
Greenville's recipe for success headed straight down I-385, and now the Golden Strip is enjoying some of that same fortune as its neighbor to the north. Our Destiny Chance shows us around Simpsonville.
All right.
You're welcome.
Even though it's changed over the years, it still feels like Simpsonville to me.
Simply home.
It's still a friendly town.
We still wave at each other, whether you know somebody or not.
A once small town dating back to the early 1800s, Simpsonville is now booming.
In 2010, I believe we were sitting right at 75,000, and we are projecting to be right around 105,000 by 2024.
It's a growing small town, as I guess is about the best way to describe Simpsonville right now, that it's still got the small town feel.
The Simpsonville Area Chamber of Commerce says according to a 2019 survey, 79% of homes are family households, one of many reasons why Scott Causey chose to raise his family in Simpsonville.
My wife's great uncle started it in 1934. So, yeah, so we had no idea we would ever work here, much less own it.
Situated in the heart of downtown across the historic clock tower, Causey and his wife own Howard's Pharmacy, one of the first businesses in Simpsonville.
This area has too much character. The building has too much character and history about it.
And inside the pharmacy, even more history. Original woodwork and bricks, and look at this, original medication vials.
We were so lucky with the bones that we had here. And I think it lends to just the overall aesthetic.
Right next door to Howard's is Sweet Sippin'.
Well, excitement is buzzing because this is Simpsonville's very first rooftop bar, making it the perfect destination for an intimate glass of wine, craft beer, and live music in the downtown area.
Julie Redman says she became an entrepreneur years ago, creating a chocolate and toffee business. She built relationships with local vendors and wanted to expand into wine, hence Sweet Sippin'.
You want to feel like you belong, that you always have a friend here.
Those same friendly customers have continued to support her, especially during the pandemic. Redman is originally from Canada and has traveled all over the world. She says there's no community quite like the Simpsonville one.
So diverse. Geographically, socioeconomically, there's so many demographics that really believe in supporting their small businesses and their community members.
I'll do the regular cones.
Okay. I definitely think during COVID, for sure, people realized how important a small business is for the community.
And that appreciation is what keeps this community tightly knit, even as it keeps evolving.
People care about each other. They know you, they shake your hand, they look you in the eye when they're talking to you.
In Simpsonville, Destiny Chance, WYFF News 4.
And we're taking lessons learned from downtown.
Sustaining and growing success.
We have to be intentional. We have to do the work, roll up our sleeves.
Successful cities looking to the future. Next on Chronicle.
Seeing cranes in a skyline often means prosperity on the city streets below. Here in Greenville, the hum of new construction is constant. But each downtown has its own blueprint for future success. A bustling downtown breathes new life into the local economy, but it takes planning and perseverance.
And so we were committed to staying in a downtown setting, refurbished our building back then, and so glad we did.
Part of downtown Greenville's modern-day success is the commitment of its big churches to stay put, even through the decline of the late 20th century.
City fathers are telling us that in the next 10 years we can expect 500,000 people, and we are seeing that growth here as a congregation. Let us quieten our hearts together.
And First Presbyterian is now committing to the future with a $34 million expansion. Those partnerships from the past are Greenville's path to the future, which now includes growing even more green.
So now we're working in the creation of Unity Park just up the river, and we're taking lessons learned from downtown.
One lesson learned: be intentional about accessibility and affordability. The city is using its own property surrounding the park to build affordable housing.
Unity Park is just down the street.
Neighboring Mountain View Baptist Church.
We stand in your presence.
A citizen since 1908.
We give you all the praise.
Is investing in that same goal.
We have to be intentional. We have to do the work, roll up our sleeves, and figure out how to keep this accessible for all families.
The name of it also suggests that you are making sure that a part of the community is not forgotten or left behind.
In an area that at one time was a classic example of segregation, where you had a black park and a white park, and we're bringing them all together and enlarging the park, and that is indeed why it's called Unity Park.
It's economic mobility. It's helping people move up, reach up, and live up in Greenville, South Carolina in a way that says quality of life is important for all of us.
These vibrant downtowns, from big and booming.
Growth can be very healthy, but it needs to be done with balance.
To small and cozy.
And our passion is to continue a family-oriented type area.
Cities that boast beautiful natural backdrops are protecting those vistas for future generations to enjoy. And Travelers Rest, that means getting codes in place today.
We make sure that buildings have to be a certain height and they can't go over those heights.
And those chefs from Greenville, the ones with the secret sauce, they say a dash of perseverance will keep the recipe fresh.
Stay in it for the long haul, and you can make significant strides in developing your downtown and making a transformational change in your community.
Having a vibrant downtown that attracts people to come explore it, come invest in it, and live in it, well, that's a winning combination for a successful future for everyone who calls that community home. Thank you for joining us for Chronicle. We hope that we've inspired you to find your destination downtown. I'm Jane Robillot. Good night.